meeting here today. Ed and your team, Joe and George, give us a lot of inspiration to give our praise to God. I consider worship leaders like cheerleaders, you know? Cheer us on to give our praise to God and appreciate their incredible gift that they have to do what they do. So inspiring. So inspiring. Who am I? We are more than. And what should our response be? This will be an interesting message for you today, I believe. I was inspired as I felt the Lord giving me this thought. You have 206 bones in your body, but you're more than that. You have 400 plus muscles, but you're a lot more than that. You have 20 square inches of skin. Actually, 20 square feet, I think it is. 20 square feet of skin weighing 6 pounds, your skin. It's the largest organ in your body. It's amazing. But we're more than that, right? We're a lot more than that. I read somewhere, and I kept this, and I used it today. If you start counting the 27 trillion cells in your body, and you count 10 per second, it will take you 100 million years to count. If you were to count 10 per second for 100 million years, you could actually count the 27 trillion cells in your body. But you're more than that. You're a lot more than that. In Genesis 1:31, and God said, everything that he had made, he beheld it, and it was not just good, it was very good. He didn't say it was just good. It was very good in the Greek, Hebrew, I mean. Very good. And in verses 26 and 27, prior to that, he said, let us make man in our own image, after our own likeness. I always am amused when I read, and let us make man. Who's us? Well, we have the Father, we have the Son, and the Holy Spirit active in creation. Let us make man. This is quite amazing. In verse 27, God created man in his own image. We're more than 27 trillion cells. We're more than 206 bones and 400 plus muscles. We're a lot more than that. David said in Psalms 139, 14, we are fearfully and wonderfully made. Now, some of us are more fearful, some of us are more wonderful. But, well, that's my little point. We're fearfully and wonderfully made, he says in Psalms 139, 14. Made in the image and likeness of God. We're made with the ability to respond in a unique relationship with God. We're made with a moral likeness to God. Not a physical resemblance, but a moral likeness to God. We were made sinless, holy creations, with a mind and with the ability to love, give, and receive love. Both. Now, we do know that was the original creation of man. God created man in his own image and likeness. But we know that that image was marred. In fact, I love doing the teachings on the potter's house. You can take a trip to the potter's house in the Old Testament, and you see the potter shaping the vessel on the wheel, and it makes an interesting remark that the vessel was marred not by the hands of the potter, but in the hands of the potter. The vessel was marred by disobedience, as we know. Who am I? We are more than. Listen, an image in the ancient world was an image to bear the ruler, the image of a ruler. And many times it was a coin or it was a seal. I think I have a coin. And I believe this Liberty coin is George. I believe it is George. So that is an image of a past ruler of this nation. And in the ancient world, that's the way, that was an authorization, or it was a representative of that ruler. Created, that image, that coin, that seal was created to bring honor to that ruler, to that monarch. Ephesians 1:12 says, we were made in the image of God, and it goes on and says, it doesn't say we're made in the image, but refers to that we are to the image of His glory. We are to bring glory to God, just as the seal or the coin went to a monarch. We bring glory to God by our lives. Amen. Now, I have a little list here for us to look at. A reflexologist, if I can say it, a reflexologist says we are a complex bundle of neuron pathways. That's what he says we are. I mean, those were more than that. The zoologist says I am the highest of the mammals. I'm the top dog, so to speak, of all the mammals. The anthropologist says, I am a social animal. Hello. Are you a social being? Yes, we are. Some of us are a little more social than others. Some of us are party animals. We'd like to, even though I think I made you laugh last Wednesday night. I said, when we get saved, we don't stop dancing. We just change partners. How do you know we can still dance? Dance with our praise to God. So the anthropologist says, I'm a social animal. The analyst, how many have ever been analyzed? I'm sure somebody probably has analyzed you. The analyst says, I am the suffering victim of social and family pressures. Oh, mercy me. Do you feel like you're a victim of social pressures? I was giving water for a reason, and I need to get it up here. Don't eat salty ham for breakfast when you're preaching. Not a good idea, but Joe went around to tell me not to, so I did, and now I suffer. So the reflexologist said we're a complex bundle of neurons. Zoologist, mammal, the highest of the mammals. The social animal of the anthropologist, the analyst, we suffer from victim of social family pressures. And the Marxist says, I'm a victim of class struggle. Everybody's trying to make us something. And I ask the question, am I just a dissected, computerized, reduced to a mass of nervous pathway, a victimized statistic? No, we're more than that, amen? We're created in the image of God to bring glory to God's name, amen? No, we're not that. As we were talking the other Wednesday night, so many people in our society are trying to make victims out of people. And people can easily identify themselves as a victim. I am amazed when I read the stories of children that came up in orphanages and how they just overcame and became success in life. They didn't let anything hold them back. Listen, God don't make any junk. Everything he made, he said, it was very good. Amen? And yes, it was marred, but the second Adam came and brought us back to where we're supposed to be with God. Amen. So we're more than what some of these people say that humanoids are. The Bible on this back page describes me more than terms of a physical universe. It describes me in terms of an eternal universe. We are eternal beings. More than just a physical thing. I know we look in the mirror a lot. I mean, there's some people who can't even pass the mirror without looking at it. I've been trying to avoid them lately myself. Sometimes it can be scary. You wake up in the morning, you kind of halfway don't know who you are. You wander in the bathroom and you wonder who the strange person is that came into your house during the night that you're looking at. Something else. We are more than physical. We are God's eternal beings. Amen. We're God's connecting link in his universe. We are that connecting link between God and his creation. In fact, man, when you look at Genesis 1, and he creates the universe, and then he creates man, and then he looks upon man as the crown of all of his creation. We are the crown of all of his creation, as great as it is. Man, God made in his own image. Man is a self-conscious being of intelligence. Rationality and responsibility of moral choices, accountability for action. Man was clothed with dignity. God gave man dominion over the kingdoms of this world. God had Adam to name all the animals. I mean, the magnificent mind that Adam had. Gracious alive. Now we know that sin in the garden diminished the capacity of what man could have maybe had. And we will be totally restored one of these days. I think the scientists say that we only use 8%, 7% of our brain and the other unused. I think before the fall, I think Adam had all 100% of his brain to do stuff. But after the fall, that seems to have changed. We are a tripartite being, body, soul, and spirit. Man is an object of God's love, created for fellowship with God. We were marred by disobedience, but God wanted to have a relationship with us. And as we grow in him, we have a richer relationship. It's almost like a child. You can have a wonderful relationship with a child, a beautiful relationship with a child, but as that child grows to adulthood, the relationship takes on a greater maturity. As we grow up in Christ and become mature Christians, mature children, we take on a deeper relationship with God as his children, growing up in Christ and having communion with God. And this is important. We will be God-like in the resurrection, but now it's time for us to be Christ-like while we're on this earth. Do you know that when the resurrection takes place, that we're going to be like him? We're going to be God-like. Amen. But now we grow in the grace and knowledge of Christ. And here on this earth, we desire to be Christ-like, whereas one day we'll be God-like in the resurrection. Romans 12, which is not in your notes, you should add, 12, 1 and 2, Paul says, I beseech ye therefore by the mercies of God, brethren, that that you present yourself, your bodies, as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto him, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. We want to live unto Christ, like unto Christ. When man became disobedient, it became God's heartbreak for sure. My spirit gives me consciousness. My soul gives me self-expression and communication with the outside world. My body gives my soul contact with the world by my senses of sight and hearing and taste and smell and touch. We have contact. Our bodies give our soul contact with the world. My soul gives me expression and communication to the outside world. My spirit man, gives me a God consciousness. I have a magazine written by several neuroscientists, and they said they believe they have discovered the God gene. That in every creation of man, God hardwired man to have a gene towards him. There's something in man that reaches out to God. It's there. And I believe it's there. David was a man after God's own heart. But again and again, he communed with his soul. Let me give you some examples. In Psalm 62:1, David said, "My soul, wait thou only upon God." Psalm 103:1, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that's within me, bless his holy name. My soul thirsteth for God. My soul shall be satisfied. My soul waits upon God." This David referring to his soul and reaching out to a God consciousness. As a disciple of Jesus Christ, I am challenged to yield all that I am. And I'm a lot more than what some people may identify me. All that I am, body, soul, and spirit, spirit, soul, and body, all that I am, we yield to him. 1 Thessalonians 5:23 says, "And the very God of peace sanctify you," W-H-O-L-L-Y, holy, complete, he says, "spirit, soul, and body." He gives the reverse, because that is really more correct. We are a spirit that lives in a body that has a soul. And with that spirit, soul, and body, we surrender to him, the Creator. I give a listing a little bit for us to ponder about what surrender really means to the Creator of our humankind that we are. Humbling ourselves before the God of the universe is what surrender means. Humbling ourselves before the God of the universe. Another one. Surrender means giving up our efforts to change others and letting God change us instead. How many has ever gotten worn out trying to change somebody else? When I do banquets and I can have a little fun on the piano, I do a song. "Change my wife, oh God, make her just like me." Well, that's the way we do it. I mean, you know, we want everybody to be like us. Well, I think if you really want to get it right, go ahead and give up. Stop trying to change others and let God change you. Amen. What about not insisting? Surrender means not insisting on having our own way, but instead submitting to God's way. I remember 20 years ago, Burger King had a big advertising campaign Come to Burger King and have it your way. And of course, Frank Sinatra's great song, I Did It My Way. Well, he may have wished he had done it God's way, because it might have been a better thing now. Submitting. Insisting on having our own way, but instead submitting to God's way. Surrender means admitting that God is all-powerful and placing our lives under His control. Amen? How many believes He does the driving better if you let Him take the wheel, right? Surrender means admitting that God is King and placing our lives under His righteous rule. Surrender means submitting to God's way of doing things, even when we don't understand. Marilyn Hickey said, don't forget when the darkness comes what God revealed to you in the light. Go ahead and keep walking in obedience to what He revealed and do the right thing. Surrender means seeking God's kingdom and putting God first in our lives. We know Matthew 6:33, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and then all these other things will be added. Surrender means praying, I want your will, not mine. Jesus prayed that prayer in the Garden of Gethsemane. Your will, not mine. I'll preach messages on that. The four words of the hardest prayer to ever pray. Your will, not mine. That's the hardest prayer. And it's only four words, but it's the hardest one to pray in the entire Bible. Your will, not mine. Man, have you ever watched little children? You can see that thing coming out of them when they're 5, 6 years old. That will, man, is strong. It's not easy to break that will, whether you're a child or whether you're a part of the adult nursery. Don't make much difference. Surrender means becoming childlike in our obedience to our Heavenly Father. And last, surrendering our independence to join the ranks of God's people everywhere, to be a part of His family. How many are glad that you're a part of the family of God? That you've been washed in the blood, cleansed, made right with Him. Who am I? We're much more than 206 bones and 400 plus muscles. We're a lot more than that. We are God's great creation made in His likeness. I just want you to give praise to God. And I'm going to do something I don't do too often. I'm going to act like Jonah. We'll stand together and I'm going to play the piano a little bit. How many want to surrender? I know. Listen, I'm going to tell you. There's times I've been surrendered to God, and there's times that I'm running so fast trying to do my own thing, it's right pitiful. I mean, you know what I'm talking about. Now, just for a moment, think that you're at Grandma's house, and just come on up here and let's have a closing song together. Come on up, let's do that together. Thank you. Holy Father.